welcome everyone for today's topic. On behalf of APA, I welcome all the PG students for today's discussion on latest treatment in asthma. I'll be guiding you through introduction and pathogenesis of asthma, asthma treatment steps, biologics in asthma, bronchial thermoplasty, and experimental approaches. Asthma is a heterogeneous chronic disease of the airway characterized by reversible airflow obstruction, bronchial hyperresponsiveness, airway inflammation, and recurrent symptoms. Today's topic's main core is on the pathogenesis, because all the drugs are on the targeted therapy. So let's know little about the pathogenesis of asthma. Allergen, when it is presented to the antigen presenting cell, it will activate Th2 cell, which will release interleukin-4, interleukin-5, interleukin-13. All these will further activate B cell, which will release immunoglobulin E, which causes degranulation of the mast cells by binding to it. The mast cell, when it is bound to IgE, itself can cause degranulation. So this degranulation causes release of histamine, prostaglandins, and leukotrienes, which cause smooth muscle contraction and stimulate the inflammatory pathway. Let us know, this is a brief on the latest GINA guidelines on asthma treatment. This slide shows stepwise therapy from mild to severe symptoms. Step one is when the patient have symptoms less than 2 times a month, or they don't have any risk factor. So in them, you can just use, as and when required, low dose inhaled corticosteroids with a combination of formoterol. Other options being low dose ICS taken whenever SABA is taken. The step two is when the symptoms are more than 2 times a month. In them, you can use daily low-dose inhaled corticosteroid or as needed low-dose inhaled corticosteroid with formoterol. Step three is when the symptoms are very severe. It's like patient is experiencing the symptoms almost every other day with nocturnal awakenings. In them, you use low dose ICS LABA. Step four is when the patient has daily symptoms with nocturnal awakenings with low lung functions. In them, you use a medium dose ICS LABA. Step five is when all these therapies have failed, with patient being on high dose ICS or LABA. So along with this, you need to add on something for their therapy. So assess for the phenotype. For example, IgG, anti-IgG, IgE, anti-IL-5 or anti-IL-4 are used, which we'll be discussing in detail at the later slides. When we say low dose or medium dose or high dose, one commonly used inhaled corticosteroid is budesonide. So the low dose of that means 200 to 400 microgram. Medium dose is 400 to 800 microgram. And high dose is more than 800 microgram. So we will be discussing today majorly on the biologics of asthma. So this is a brief. IgE antibody, that is omalizumab, was the first FDA approved antibody. So let us read the importance of IgE in asthma pathway. When the allergen is attached to the antigen presenting cell, it will activate T cell, further leading to Th2 cell differentiation, which releases interleukin 4 and 13 and activate B cell, causing the release of IgE. These IgE are in free form. They have high affinity to Fc epsilon receptor or present on the mast cell or the basophil. When it is bound in this state, the mast cell or the basophil releases histamine, prostaglandins, and leukotrienes, which causes the inflammation. So, omalizumab, which is the first FDA approved biologic treatment, it is an IgG1 monoclonal antibody, a recombinant DNA derived IgG, which inhibits the Fc portion of the IgE antibody. So this IgE cannot bind to the mast cells or the basophils. So further, there is no release of all those mediators and inflammation is reduced. Omalizumab is used in patients more than 6 years of age in moderate to severe persistent asthma, despite high doses of inhaled corticosteroids. But you need to have a total serum IgE of at least 30 to 700 international units before starting omalizumab. So the dose of omalizumab is 150 to 375 milligram administered subcutaneously every 2 to 4 weeks. Duration of the treatment is not determined. If the patient responds well, can be used on a long term. There is no dose adjustments in asthma or hepatic or renal impairment. The major side effects being nasopharyngitis, headache, recurrent upper respiratory tract infection, sinusitis, and the severe side effect being the anaphylaxis. They say that this anaphylaxis is so rarely found that compared to all other biologic therapy, omalizumab is the safest in causing anaphylaxis. So it is on rare. There are 13 trials which were based on this omalizumab. One study is PERSIST study and EXPERIENCE study. They showed that there is decreased rate of asthma exacerbation and inhaled corticosteroid dose requirement, hospitalization, and emergency department visits. Another trial called INNOVATE trial. This trial said when omalizumab was stopped, 18 to 20 weeks later, IgE levels returned back to the baseline values. So omalizumab is of no help. But contrast to this study was a France retrospective study, which said discontinuation was not associated with any rebound effect or exacerbation of the disease. Another major study is several studies on omalizumab had shown that omalizumab actually increased the risk of malignancy. So one study which said it is negative is the EXCELS study, the epidemiologic study of Xolair. It is a post-marketing prospective cohort study which showed that there was no risk of malignancy. But it did say that there were increased rate of transient ischemic attack or ischemic stroke. Now coming to interleukin 4 or interleukin 13. Interleukin 4 and interleukin 13 are again released by the T cells, mast cells, and the basophils. They act commonly via binding to interleukin 4 receptor alpha subunit. That causes downstream signaling of STAT6, which causes TH2 differentiation, airway inflammation and remodeling, macrophage and dendritic cell activation, B cell activation, airway epithelial and goblet cell stimulation, and airway hyperresponsiveness. So the antibodies against them is, first one is dupilumab. Dupilumab is a human monoclonal IgG4 antibody that inhibits the interleukin 4 receptor alpha subunit, thereby inhibiting interleukin 4 and 13 cytokine and their inflammatory responses. It is administered subcutaneously. Initially, it was initial dose is 400 or 600 milligram, and a maintenance dose is 200 or 300 milligram once a week. It was administered in moderate to severe asthma patients and pediatric patients greater than 12 years with the eosinophilic phenotype, or the one who require high doses of corticosteroids. Dupilumab showed that there was improvement in FEV1, asthma control questionnaire score, decreased nocturnal awakening, and reduced use of SABA rescue, reduced biomarkers of TH2 inflammation. Another in this group is lebrikizumab. Lebrikizumab is IgG4 humanized monoclonal antibody, which blocks interleukin 13. It is again administered subcutaneously with a dose of 125 milligram every 4 weeks. At 12 weeks, the mean FEV1 was increased by 5.5%, and this increase was more in patient who had high serum periostin levels. But lebrikizumab did not have any differences in asthma exacerbation, symptom scores, or beta agonist rescue use. The major side effects being aplastic anemia, increased peripheral eosinophil count. Tralokinumab, it is again an IgG4 monoclonal antibody to interleukin 13. It inhibits bronchial hyperresponsiveness and airway eosinophilia. It causes improved FEV1 and reduced use of SABA. It was more in patients who had elevated sputum interleukin 13, but this did not reduce eosinophil count, suggesting that interleukin 13 is not essential for eosinophilic airway inflammation. We'll go on to the third biologic group, that is interleukin 5 antibodies. Interleukin 5 is a major pro-inflammatory cytokine, which is again released by the TH2 cells, mast cells, and basophils. Interleukin 5 causes eosinophilic proliferation, differentiation, and activation. And all this will further release, causing airway inflammation. So the antibodies towards interleukin 5 is mepolizumab, reslizumab, benralizumab. These are all humanized monoclonal antibody. Against interleukin 5, which inhibits eosinophilic inflammation and reduces the number of eosinophils in sputum and blood. mepolizumab, which comes with the brand name of Nucala, used as an add-on maintenance therapy for severe asthma in patients with age more than 12 years with eosinophilic phenotype. The main criteria for all this interleukin 5 is the absolute eosinophil count should be more than 300 micro ml. Again, mepolizumab administered subcutaneously, 100 milligram once every 4 weeks. Certain studies were done under mepolizumab. Mepolizumab's first study was serious study, which was conducted in 135 patients who were randomly assigned mepolizumab and placebo group. Administered at a dose of 100 milligram showed that there was reduction in glucocorticoid dose use 2.3 times greater, reduction in exacerbation and improved control of asthma symptoms. Another trial on mepolizumab, that is MENSA trial, which was done in 576 patients. In them, 75 milligram was administered every 4 weeks, and it showed decreased exacerbation rate by 47% if given intravenously and 53% when given subcutaneously compared to the placebo group. And in 32 weeks, there was increase in the baseline FEV1 from baseline FEV1 about 100 ml. So MENSA trial also talked about the routes of administration of mepolizumab. One is the intravenous and the other being the subcutaneous, and both showed similar efficacy. DREAM trial. In this trial, 621 patients were recorded in administered via IV formulation with a dose of 75 milligram, 250 milligram, and 750 milligram. It is administered in 13 infusions every 4 weekly, and this again showed reduced exacerbations by 52%. Reslizumab, again used as an add-on maintenance therapy in patients aged greater than 18 years with eosinophilic phenotype, at a dose of 3 mg per kg IV infusion over 20 to 50 minutes, administered 4 weekly. The major adverse effects of reslizumab being oropharyngeal pain, which is the most common one, and anaphylaxis. A multi-center double-blind placebo phase 3 trial showed that there was greater reduction in sputum eosinophil count and improved airflow obstruction with asthma control questionnaire and SABA rescue. Now coming to benralizumab. Benralizumab is a cytotoxic monoclonal antibody directed against interleukin 5 receptor alpha. This depletes interleukin 5 receptor bearing cells, that is eosinophils and basophils, enhanced antibody dependent cytotoxicity, and also blocks interleukin 5 binding to its receptor. The common side effects being headache, pharyngitis, urticaria. Two major trials of benralizumab is Sirocco trial and Kalima trial, which showed that there was reduced exacerbation and improved FEV1. Zonda trial showed that benralizumab has glucocorticoid sparing effect. All these TH2 pathway is the one which is most commonly seen in majority of the patients. And in these TH2 pathway mediated asthma, the asthma symptoms are comparatively less severe and they actually respond to in corticosteroid. But there is another pathway in the asthma, that is interleukin 17 pathway, which has neutrophilic predominance. And this pathway, patients with this pathway have severe symptoms and responds well to corticosteroids. So the TH17 cell releases interleukin 17A, interleukin 17F, and interleukin 22. All these leads to release of neutrophil, which further causes airway inflammation, airway remodeling, and increased mucus. So there are two drugs in the interleukin 17 antibody studies, secukinumab and brodalumab. They are in the clinical trials for asthma treatment. Secukinumab is a monoclonal antibody targeted at interleukin 17A. All these drugs are actually being used in patients with psoriasis and rheumatoid arthritis. For asthma, it is still in the trial. And brodalumab is a monoclonal antibody against interleukin 17 receptor alpha, used in moderate to severe asthma patients. So this is a table showing which all biologics are being marketed. So key points are IgE, that is omalizumab, it is marketed. Interleukin 5, mepolizumab and reslizumab are being marketed. Interleukin 5 receptor alpha, that is benralizumab, is being marketed. And interleukin 4 receptor alpha, that is depilumab, is being marketed. The rest of the drugs are still in the clinical phase trials. So the future biologics being, some studies have targeted on T2 inflammation, which releases the interleukin 25, interleukin 13, and thymic stromal lymphopoietin. The antibody against thymic stromal lymphopoietin is tezepelumab, which reduces exacerbation, decreased markers of T2 inflammation, IgE levels, and pheno. The other biologics and small molecule antagonists targeting kinases are being developed. And all these biologics which we read till now were given either in subcutaneous form or intravenous form. So the future would be on nebulized biologic therapy. So we'll go on to the second part of this discussion, that is bronchial thermoplasty. This is a technique of applying heat to airways during bronchoscopy, which reduces the increased mass of airway smooth muscle associated with asthma. The criteria for bronchial thermoplasty is a patient should have poorly controlled asthma, non-smoker for greater than 1 year, FEV1 more than 60% predicted, and no history of life-threatening exacerbations or less than 3 hospitalization in the previous 12 months. And ALAIR is the FDA-approved bronchial thermoplasty system. So this is the one I'll be describing on the procedure. It entails 3 separate bronchoscopies under moderate sedation about 3 weeks apart. A radio frequency controller and specialized catheter are being used to administer thermal energy. And the target tissue temperature is 65 degrees Celsius to airway walls. All accessible airways distal to main stem bronchus of a diameter of 3 to 10 mm are treated. So the trials are, there was one systematic review and meta-analysis which had the 3 trial groups. in them, none of them had clinically significant quality of life at the end of 12 months, and none showed any difference in the pulmonary function parameters. But the exacerbation rates were lower in two of the trial groups, though there was increase in hospitalization for the respiratory events during the treatment period. AIR-2 is a major trial in bronchial thermoplasty, which is an asthma intervention research trial. In this trial, 288 patients with pre-bronchodilator FEV1 greater than 60% were randomly assigned bronchial thermoplasty or the sham procedure. In them, 16 subjects, that is 8% of the bronchial thermoplasty group, required 19 hospitalization for acute respiratory symptoms within the 6 weeks of the treatment. But later, post 1 year, there were lowered exacerbation or emergency department visits. Pre-bronchodilator FEV1 values remained stable. There was no changes in that. This is a diagram showing that the asthma symptoms and emergency visits and hospitalization were reduced after 1 year in the bronchial thermoplasty group compared to the sham group, placebo group. RISA trial is another trial in bronchial thermoplasty research in severe asthma, in which 32 patients were randomly assigned. Bronchial thermoplasty resulted in an initial worsening of asthma control and 7 hospitalization in 15 patients of the 32. Perioperative period, improvement in rescue medication use and asthma control questionnaire scores that persisted for the next 52 weeks of the study. So bronchial thermoplasty is associated with short-term increase in asthma-related morbidity. However, there is preliminary evidence of long-lasting improvement in asthma control. So this is a figure again showing the changes in this course in the first 22 weeks and later after 52 weeks. So all this shows that in the bronchial thermoplasty group, the rates were reduced. Another trial after the marketing, a real-world study of 190 patients treated with bronchial thermoplasty, and this trial was actually compared with the AIR-2 trial. This trial is PAS-2 trial, named as PAS-2 trial, that is post FDA approval clinical trial evaluation. In PAS2 participants experienced more exacerbation and hospitalization in the first 12 months. At 3 years after bronchial thermoplasty, it decreased significantly. So the other experimental approaches being immunomodulatory therapy, as asthma is a major inflammatory disorder. Anti-inflammatory properties of certain agents can cause decrease in the inflammation. So two drugs were studied in this, that is methotrexate and cyclosporin, and they actually showed that glucocorticoid sparing effect. The other immunomodulatory agents directed at interleukin 13, interleukin 2R, thymic stromal lymphopoietin are under trial. The latest GINA guidelines also talked about macrolide antibiotics, which has antimicrobial and anti-inflammatory action. So azithromycin was commonly used. Two trials one with an eosinophilic asthma and another with non-eosinophilic asthma. A eosinophilic asthma trial is AMACE trial, and non-eosinophilic is AZISTAT trial. Both these trials showed decreased rates of exacerbation and improved quality of life. They had administered 500 milligram of azithromycin thrice in a week. The duration of the treatment is not being described. So thank you.